Thank you for the very kind introduction. I don't know how much you've heard of the previous history of medicine in Granite City or the Tri-Cities. So I talked to Mrs. Engel this evening and asked her how much information you'd had about the beginning of Granite City. I have a history of our hospital, St. Elizabeth Medical Center, and I think I'm going to read this because it includes a great deal of the past history of our city. I'm going to read this first, then I'm going to talk to you about some of my experiences when I first came to Granite City. It was fun. For over three quarters of a century, St. Elizabeth Medical Center, Granite City, Illinois, has been serving the Metro East area, the metropolitan area across the Mississippi River from St. Louis, Missouri, just like we didn't know, with quality health care. St. Elizabeth employs over 1,100 people and has 421 licensed acute care beds. It's hard to imagine just how close Granite City came to not having a hospital at all. It's an interesting story, and one that begins even before the hospital was constructed, because to examine the history of St. Elizabeth Hospital, it's necessary to look at the history of Granite City as well. In 1904, that was before I was born, I'm only young, you know, as the World's Fair was opening in St. Louis, industry was shaping Granite City. Factories which had sprung up around St. Louis had spread eastward across the Mississippi to a fertile area of Illinois bottomland, which had been known as the Six Mile Prairie because the small settlement of cabins there was 6 miles from St. Louis. Granite City's heritage was a bit different from most other towns. It was, in fact, an instant city, created through the efforts of two brothers, the Niedringhauses. They were the owners of what was, in the 1800s, St. Louis Stamping Company, a prosperous kitchen utensil business. While vacationing in Germany, William Niedringhaus came across a metal shop producing pots and pans with a satin-like sheen, unlike anything available in the United States. Niedringhaus paid the shop owner $5,000 to show him the process, which involved ground granite and return to the United States to acquire a patent. Soon the Niedringhauses had a booming business in what they called granite ware. To produce granite ware, they built a granite iron rolling mill in St. Louis, not far from the St. Louis Stamping Company. But by 1890, demanded for their products has grown so large, the brothers had to look for a new place to expand the factories. Rather than add on to existing facilities in St. Louis, they decided to build a new plant in less expensive Illinois. It was less expensive in Illinois then, in 1890. 6 Mile Prairie was the place. In 1894, after careful planning, workers arrived in the fields of Old 6 Mile, and an entire city was born. Factories, streets, and homes simultaneously rode out of what had been, only a few years earlier, farmland. When deciding on a name, the Niedringhaus brothers chose to pay homage to what had made them successful industrialists. They were Granite Ware, result Granite City. Heavy industries were constructed in the new city, including Granite City Steel Company and St. Louis Stamping Works. Railroads crisscrossed the area to bring supplies to the mills. An unfortunate reality of heavy industry at the turn of the century was, however, injuries. It wasn't long before a hospital was needed for Granite City. Dr. Ralph Niedringhaus, grandnephew of William, was one of the prime movers of the hospital project. In 1904, construction began on what was called Granite City Hospital. When the hospital was finished in 1905, it opened under the auspices of the Lutheran Hospital Association. Reverend Olmsted was named president of the hospital, which included a nurses' training school. Dr. Robert Binney. Anybody recognize that name? Of course. For whom the present Binney Wing is named, was the first doctor to practice at Granite City Hospital, performing the first operation and delivering the first baby. Although hopes were high for quality care in Granite City, it didn't take long before problems appeared. Most of the factory workers who came for treatment were poor. So much of the treatment given by the Granite City Hospital was charitable. A noble tradition, perhaps, but unfortunately, one that couldn't last forever. Financial difficulties mounted quickly. So quickly that the hospital faced bankruptcy in 1910 and was forced to close, only 5 years after opening. It seems as though dreams of a hospital in Granite City vanished almost overnight. However, it was not all lost. Some years earlier, in 1896, a Catholic priest, Bobby Kenders, had opened a small hospital in Venice. Well, Father Kenders was pastor at the church in Venice, and then heavy industry came to the Metro East. Many residents left Venice and moved to Granite City. Father Kenders' hospital, which was named St. Elizabeth, had to close. There wasn't enough business in Venice. Right, Milton? Oh, you're just a kid, I know. But he didn't lose his desire to found a hospital. When Granite City Hospital closed in 1910, when it went bankrupt, he saw a golden opportunity to reopen it and give his own dream of a Catholic hospital another chance. Well, there were many, many problems. At Father's invitation, the missionary sisters of Holy Ghost came from Techne, Illinois, and they folded up. After struggling with Father Kenders' well-meant intention, but sometimes domineering supervision, sisters of the Holy Ghost came and left. Later, in 1916, sisters of St. Francis took over, and nothing happened. Unfortunately, difficulties with the strong Kenders' will against caused enough friction for the sisters of St. Francis to leave. They left in 1918. Then Father Kenders sought secular help. Unfortunately, the employees that he could afford to hire were at best unreliable, and conditions at the hospital got worse. Things got slightly better during World War I, as peak demand for steel drove the value of the Granite City manufactured goods to nearly $18 million. In those days, it was a lot of money. As prosperity in the face of war came to Granite City, it also came to St. Elizabeth Hospital. Although the hospital was still far from being stable, medically and financially, Father Kenders fought almost single-handedly to keep the hospital open until 1921, when the Sisters of Divine Providence, the present nuns at the hospital now, came to Granite City after learning of St. Elizabeth's distress. 1921 was barely 3 days old when they arrived to make still another attempt to get the hospital back on its feet. The sisters bought the hospital from Father Kenders in 1921 before actually arriving in Granite City. They had a massive cleanup job waiting for them when they got here, as well as an incredible lack of equipment and materials. There weren't any linens, no x-ray machine, and lots of bills remained unpaid. In spite of that, I remember sisters telling me that they fed the poor. Every day they had what bread was left over from the previous day, they fed it to the poor, any food that was left. And not only that, but they themselves did the laundry and cleaned the rooms and mopped the floors of the hospital to save on the expenses. And surely by scrimping, saving, and doing a lot of work themselves instead of hiring others, the sisters slowly began to turn things around. By the end of 1921, almost 600 patients had been admitted, but it wasn't until October 1922 that the hospital was in the black. Positive balance of $8.76. Even after that, the hospital's finances continued to be rocky until 1923, when things settled down. Since then, the hospital has grown, with new additions in 1931, 1944, 1958, 1969, and 1971. St. Elizabeth Medical Center is still growing, but buildings aren't all that had expanded. Community services have also. Now our hospital is not only a hospital, but it's a medical center, and doesn't really describe all the community-oriented programs the center is involved. All kinds of activities I will tell you about a little later. When the Binney Wing was being built, we had a drive for money, finances, naturally. And one day I was sitting there and I was thinking, you know, that Binney Wing is going to be nice. It was the new wing, East Wing, at the time. And I thought to myself, I wonder what it would cost to name that wing. So I called the drive chairman. I said, what would it cost to name the wing that we are planning on building? He says, very glibly, $100,000. $100,000. Where are we going to get $100,000? And it so happened that Dr. Binney had just died fairly recently. So I visited Mrs. Binney. And we talked, I mean, she talked. And we visited for quite a while. And she signed the pledge for $100,000. And that's how come we named the Binney Wing. Now that is a short synopsis of our hospital, which I think is extremely important because it is the center of the health care of this community. And it's widening, it's getting larger. Every field is being encompassed by it. So, I was born and raised in Chicago, educated in Chicago, graduated from medical school in 1935, which would be 50 years next year. Finished my internship in 1936, was married, practiced in Chicago for a year, then came to Granite City in 1938. Many things were a little bit different then. I had an office in the Darner building, and I think our office visit was $2. The first month, I actually collected $16. I thought, oh my gosh, what a place. How did I happen to get here? Well, my husband was from Granite, and I thought I'd like a smaller town to practice in. And names like Drs. Binney, Dr. Dale, remember Dr. Dale? Darner. Do I see any smiling faces? Dr. Everett, Dr. Phillips, Dr. Ham, Harlan, Rice, Shermer, Arnovitz. Remember Dr. Nagel? He was our ENT man, our ear, nose, and throat specialist. and Dr. Smith. Those are some of the names I ran into when I came to Granite City. And some of you are familiar with the sisters at the hospital. We had Sister Cleta. Remember Sister Cleta? She remembers. Oh, she was a good one. Listen, any nurse that went through that operating room in her training was a real honest-to-goodness nurse. She was so strict, it was pathetic. Those girls would go off in the hall and cry every day. Then we had Sister Petronella, Sister Euphrosine. Sister Theodora is still with us. And Sister Benedict. I think some of you remember them. I thought I'd recall that to your mind. You know, we had to make house calls. And this was rather interesting. I was a perfect stranger here. My husband was still in school. In fact, maybe he was interning by then. And I knew nothing about Granite City or the Tri-City area. So when I get a call to make a house call, I said, well, where is this house? Well, you know that tavern on such and such. You make a right, and then when you come to this tavern, you make a left. In other words, the taverns were the strategic landmarks of the city. To this day, I still don't know one from another. Someday we're going to have to find out. It was kind of fun because we had all kinds of interesting cases. For instance, one evening, mother called me desperately. The baby was crying and crying, just a young baby, and wouldn't stop it, just screaming constantly. Okay, would I come over? Okay, so you go to that tavern, go to this tavern, and there's a house, the third house from the corner. Fine, I got there. Walked into the house, and they had a potbelly stove in the middle of the room. And next to that potbelly stove, and it was very hot, it was really hot, the baby's crib was set. And the baby was dressed in a woolen suit with with quilts and blankets and all sorts of things. I took one look in there, poor little kid, and I don't blame him. I stripped that little kid, pulled the crib away, I said, now he's going to stop crying, and he did. Well, that's the kind of house calls we made. What did we treat pneumonias with? What did we treat meningitis with? Aspirin. That's all we had. And you know, it's amazing some of them survived. It really is. When you stop to think, with all these fancy antibiotics we have now, they actually survived. I have a meningitis case and pneumonia case that I still take care of. Well, when I first came to Granite, I applied at the hospital for membership on the staff. Had no problem getting on. But somehow or another, the boys weren't very too receptive. I'd go to the cafeteria for a cup of coffee, and I'd sit there, and they'd all bunch off at another table, and they'd look over at me. But it wasn't long before we became friends. And I've had some of the most beautiful friendships with the doctors on our staff. We didn't have any specialists. We were all general practitioners. We depended on problem cases to be cared for by specialists from St. Louis. Do you remember streetcars on Madison Avenue? Yeah. You know, we didn't have a public health department when I came here, but I understand back in the late 20s, a Dr. Huggins was a veterinarian, public health department, and his job was to test cows for tuberculosis. That's the extent of a public health department in our area. Would you believe we still don't have a public health department in Madison County? It was voted down a few years ago by most of the people in Alton. Well, they're talking about one. Maybe we'll get one eventually. Now, when I came here, the hospital had 125 beds. Surgery was on the fourth floor. Of course, we had no air conditioning. We didn't know what that was. We had two operating rooms, excuse me, and one small operating room. And Sister Kalita ruled that department with an iron hand. Believe you me, it was an iron hand. But we loved her for it. And you know, we had screens in the windows, and the old enemies, the flies, would get in there. And we'd be swatting them around. We didn't want any contamination. In the operating room, of course, we just had simple ether, chloroform, and gas for anesthesia. Now we have seven operating rooms equipped with the most modern equipment, electrocardiogram monitoring, and all kinds of mechanisms to make sure the patient does well during surgery. We now have, in the operating room we have five general surgical rooms. No, we have one back. We have seven operating rooms. Yes, five general surgical rooms, two thoracic surgeons, two vascular surgeons, three orthopedic surgeons, six urologists, three ophthalmologists, one ear, nose, and throat specialist, three plastic surgeons, four dental surgeons, three anesthesiologists, and four nurse anesthetists. We had no recovery room back in 1938, but now we have one with 10 beds and constant supervision of the patients. We've come a long way. In 1938, the OB department was on the third floor. There, too, we just had screens. And we had to fight flies. No air conditioning. At that time, we delivered babies for $25. Do I hear snicker? Of course, grandchildren and great-grandchildren tell a different tale now. We had one labor room with six beds. Now we have five labor rooms and two delivery rooms. And they're switching to the birthing rooms. In those days, we wouldn't even let the father outside of the father's waiting room. Now the entire family could come in and view the delivery. It's nice. Husbands, children, families. We now have four seven bassinet nurseries. And you know, it's amazing. The other day somebody said, do you know we have 17 babies in the nursery at one time? We used to have 30 and 35 every day, all the time, and thought nothing of it. We did home deliveries. I'll never forget, I had a home delivery. Got there maybe about 3:30, and this woman had a number of little children running around, in and out the door. It was during the summer, and I was preparing to deliver this patient, getting her ready. And there was a WPA worker helping this mother out. And when it came to be 4 o'clock, she came over and she took her apron off and she says, I have to go. I said, where are you going? Here the woman's ready to deliver. The kid's running in and out. Well, WPA orders, and off she went. You can imagine the fun I had. Chasing the kids and trying to deliver this baby and clean up the baby and get things. That was fun. And home deliveries, we did those all the time. You know, I kind of enjoyed them, though. There was a closeness there that you don't get in the hospital. That's just my personal view. We didn't have any intensive care unit, of course. And if we had a very critical patient, the patient would be put to bed. The oxygen tank was wheeled in, clamped on the nose and whatnot. And The nurses were always very nice. They were very, very interested in the patients. They were concerned. They loved the patients, and they gave them beautiful care. We now have an intensive care with 12 rooms, and in the Benny Wing we have coronary care unit, pulmonary rehabilitation, and all kinds of services that we didn't have back in 1938, almost 50 years ago. We now have 11 internists, 5 pediatricians, 3 oncologists, that's cancer specialists, 8 family practitioners, 2 gastroenterologists, and a pulmonary specialist. We're blessed with them, and it's nice to have them, believe you me. Now, the emergency room, I imagine some of you remember the nice little cubby hole we had on the ground floor. I remember I was scrubbing to suture a child's scalp. And the nurse came into the emergency room. Now, this is later than 1938, and she said, "John Kennedy was just shot." Well, there I was scrubbing. I couldn't wipe my eyes, but my tears were rolling down my cheeks. And I came over to suture this youngster's scalp, and he looked at me and says, "Doctor, why are you crying?" You know, it was such a shock. But the child didn't realize at the time what that really meant. Had a lot of interesting experiences in the emergency room. Now they have 8 examining rooms and 8 treatment rooms in the emergency room. X-ray was very, very skimp. Dr. Schnobelin, does anybody remember him? And Sister Pacomia, they ran the X-ray department. We just had, I think, 1 or 2 X-ray machines, and worked out pretty well. We got the information we wanted at the time. Now we have 8 radiologists, X-ray specialists. We have nuclear medicine, we have CT scanners, we have ultrasound, cobalt treatments, you name it. That department has really grown. They now have 7 X-ray rooms and all these other treatment rooms. In about, I'd say, 1940 or thereabouts, I was secretary of the medical staff, and each Christmas it was my duty to purchase from the doctor's treasury of the staff Christmas gifts for each employee and the sisters, each individually. Well, it wasn't too bad until the numbers of employees, associates, began to grow. We had to give that up. However, we always had to pay for our sutures in surgery. Sister Cleta kept a close eye on the amount of sutures we used. Now, if it was a long process with a lot of sutures, it really cost them. Sister Cleta was right there. Well, we conserved on sutures. And now when I see him just open one, put in a couple of sutures, throw it away, it frightens me. But that's because I'm old-fashioned. Don't pay any attention to it. We used to buy the stethoscopes for the floors, too. That was my job also. Because somehow they disappear. You know, we buy stethoscopes for each floor and so forth, and pretty soon they're gone. It still happens, doesn't it? Still happens. But we don't have to buy them anymore. And then we also furnished bed lights and call system. In 1963, we established an immunization clinic. This was for the low-income group people who can't afford to pay the doctors for the immunizations. And the doctors are always willing to refer these little ones to our clinic. And in the 20 years we had it, we did 34,120 immunizations. That's quite a record. None of these children would have had these immunizations, very likely. And of course the schools now are very happy to have the immunization clinic, but they won't allow a child to come to school unless he has the required number of immunizations. Then in 1979, they developed the hospice program. I was happy to be a charter member of the board. When I first came to Granite, we had to teach the nurses. The staff were the teachers. We each had our own field. I taught pediatrics. Now they go to the universities and get their degrees and so forth. But it was nice to be able to teach these nurses. Now, when I first came here, TB Hospital and the Alton Mental Hospital were always filled to capacity. With the new medications for TB, there's no need for a TB hospital anymore. We have an outpatient clinic in Edwardsville. The mental health patients do not need hospitalization or restraints now. They come to the mental health clinic, they're treated outpatients. They have homes for some of them where they rehabilitate them and so forth, which is a far cry from the old insane hospital, as we used to call it. In 1979, we had our first coffee shop at the hospital. And this was kind of nice. The Chamber of Commerce Women's Division sponsored it. Lieutenant Governor Paul Simon cut the ribbon and so forth. It was real nice. To sum it all up, when I first came here, we had very little to work with. Incidentally, I have something to show you. Where's my... There. When I first came to Granite, this was the book we used for useful drugs. This is our useful drug book today. So you see, this is what we had to work with. What did we treat them? As I say, aspirin, turpentine stoops in the abdomen when they were distended. We treated syphilis with bismuth intramuscularly and arsenicals intravenously until good old penicillin came along. That's fairly well eradicated. However, we now have genital herpes, toxic shock, and AIDS, and we still don't know how to treat them. So how far have we gotten? It's rather interesting. I'm so happy, and I feel very privileged that I was able to be in this area from 1938, when we had so little to work with, till now. I saw all the progress. Antibiotics, nuclear medicine coming in, and it's been wonderful to be able to study and stay with it. I hope I could stay on a few more years. I'd love to see what happens next. You've been a very, very kind audience. I appreciate your interest, and I appreciate your inviting me. Thank you so very much. I enjoyed it.